Thank you for this introduction. Yes, this part is not about the beer itself, although I listened with interest to the last session. This is about the beer consumer, so to speak. And we have quite a lot of them in the Netherlands. Maybe not as much and not as good beer as in Belgium, but still sufficient, I would say. Can I go to the next one somehow? How can I go to the next one? Oh, with this one. Oh, okay. Okay, thank you. The rationale for our study. I should say we are nutrition scientists as well as epidemiologists. So I started research on alcohol some years ago. This is a famous slide. You already saw it by Professor Witte. The Y-shaped association between alcohol intake and, for example, the risk of coronary heart disease from various cohorts. And we're not going to debate that. We had another history, the French paradox, as already introduced in the 1990s. A very low risk of coronary heart disease in France, for example, while the diet was perhaps still quite rich in what we think the bad nutrients, saturated fat and dietary cholesterol. And the explanation could be that the registration of causes of death in French were not that good. But it could also be the high consumption of wine, and nowadays particularly we think about the red wine, for example, not only because of the ethanol, but for example also based on the polyphenols, as discussed before the break. Now, an interesting paper is from a Danish group, the Copenhagen City Heart Study, already 14 years ago, and they saw that moderate alcohol consumption was associated with lower mortality compared to non-drinkers, as you can see here. But you saw especially that this was especially clear for the wine drinkers and less so for the beer drinkers. And we were wondering about that. So it seemed that this protective association of wine and coronary heart disease, we now are all familiar with, was confirmed in also other observational studies. So it was easier to detect this inverse association with wine than with beer. Well, why could this be? Well, a lot of these studies speculated that it could be something in the wine, and I think the resveratrol already mentioned this morning could be one of the explanations, although more recently there is some debate about that, but maybe we come to that later today. But it could also be, and that was our thinking, that there could be other factors involved, maybe also lifestyle or psychosocial factors. Here, for example, Kletsky indeed had lower mortality wine drinkers than the beer or liquor drinkers. But what he showed that wine drinkers were more often female, a college graduate, so had higher education, for example, non-smoker and didn't drink so much, so were like more moderate drinkers. So there were quite a lot of differences between the beer and the wine drinkers. And I have to say that in many epidemiologic studies, they looked at alcohol and mortality and adjusted, for example, for smoking, an important confounder, but often other dietary intake was not investigated. So that was something like some sort of what we call residual confounding, because beer, we have hypothesized that beer drinkers could have other diets as well. There were also some other evidence from literature. There could be an influence on drinking pattern. There is some evidence from a Danish group that beer drinkers, at least probably in Copenhagen, I don't know, are more likely to progress to heavier drinking. That can be possible. Social class, again, was found also by a Danish group. Personal variables, higher IQ, maybe also related to higher education. And subjective health, so they were less healthy, at least to their own report. All Danish information, but quite interesting, I think. So this points out that there are, in observational studies, some fundamental differences between beer and wine drinkers. But not much was reported on diet. And that's what we wanted to check. So what we did first is a systematic review, and you haven't seen it yet. It's now in press in a review journal, Critical Reviews in Food Science and Nutrition. Our research question was to look at the alcoholic beverage preference and dietary habits in healthy adults. So we looked at the search in the various databases, and we found quite many hits. But in the end, we were able to include 16 studies from literature, to base our conclusions on. There were 14 cross-sectional studies. And two ecological studies. So in a cross-sectional study, we measure at the same time your dietary intake and your alcohol intake, your preference. And also two ecological studies, so they look more on the group level. They don't look at individual intake or individual drinking habits, but more on the population level. So look at households and supermarket transactions. They were done in various countries, so you can see the US, but also in various countries in Europe, in the north and in the south. And the first one was from 1997. And this is, I'll show you in the next slide, some summaries of our results. Well, if you look at the alcoholic beverage preference, what people like or drink most, so to speak, in Denmark, United States, and Finland, most women preferred wine and most men preferred beer. I don't know if this is in Belgium the same or if this is your own country the same, but I suspect this can be quite similar in many, at least Northern European countries. And not unsurprisingly, France, Italy, and Spain, the studies showed that the majority of the total population preferred wine, although I now know more recently, perhaps beer drinking is also getting a little bit more popular in Sicily, or, well, you'll hear more about this after me. What about the people with a beer preference? We found that when they bought more beer in the supermarkets, they bought less healthy foods, more unhealthy products. In the US study, adults who preferred beer had lowest intake of fruit and vegetables and least healthy diet. And Spanish beer drinkers also adhered less to the dietary guidelines. So based on the literature, this suggests that the beer drinkers usually are not prefer a healthy diet, so to speak. But we didn't see a big difference between the Western and the Mediterranean population, so the results were a little bit similar in the north and south of Europe. And in general, we can say that the peer preference was more dominant in males and more in smokers. That's correlated, I suppose. And persons with a beer preference had highest educational attainment, but only in some some studies. It was opposite in other studies. Then the wine drinkers had a higher educational attainment. Regarding the wine, because I'm also talking about wine, not only about beer, we found quite some difference between the Northern Europe and United States versus the Mediterranean area. And in our part of Europe, the northern part, wine preference was associated with higher intake of fruit and vegetable, fish and salads in a Danish population. Also in the US, we found a higher intake of fruits and vegetables and fiber, a lower intake of fast food. So it seems that wine drinkers had healthier dietary habits, at least in those studies. And they had higher socioeconomic status, so higher attained education, for example, lower BMI, and also more likely to be female, which of course can be explain a little bit the lower BMI, but not always. But in the Mediterranean countries, it was less clear. So the differences we saw in the fact that the wine drinkers had healthier dietary habits in the Northern European was not so much in the Mediterranean countries. Spanish wine consumers, for example, were not healthier or unhealthier diets, had no healthier or unhealthier diets. There was no association between wine and intake of fruit and vegetables in Italians. No difference to adherence of Mediterranean diet in Spain and in France. And again, those who preferred wine, they were in the Mediterranean area older and had higher BMI. So if you are from a Mediterranean country, you can think yourself if this is plausible. I cannot verify that. But this is what we found in the literature. So what we conclude is that this alcoholic beverage preference, especially wine and beer, is related to specific dietary habits. Actually, also in Europe, at least, depending on the living area. So especially in the Northern European countries, where a lot of these epidemiological studies on wine and beer have been done. But it's also associated not only with diet, but also other factors like age, sex, BMI, smoking habits, and education. So in the Western countries, Northern Europe, Western Europe, and the US, persons with a wine preference had in general healthier dietary habits. And those who preferred beer had less healthier dietary habits, but that was also the case in the Mediterranean area. The second part of the talk, I'd like to go a little bit more in depth, because next, the next step was that we looked at our own data in the Netherlands. And this paper was recently published in the European Journal of Clinical Nutrition. So we looked at alcoholic beverage preference and the diet quality, and this was based on a very recent Dutch National Food Consumption Survey, which was published in 2012. We had more than 2,000 men and women in a national representative sample between 19 and 69 years of age. And we had an alcoholic beverage preference based on the general questionnaire. And we decided that if the average number of reported glasses of a specific beverage was more than 70% of total alcohol intake, we decided it was that preference. So if the 70, more than 70% of the alcohol was from beer in a person, that we said this person has a beer preference, or a wine preference, or a spirits preference, or no preference, or non-alcoholic, no, not drinking. The diet information was quite good. It was based on two non-consecutive 24-hour recalls, and that is a usual way we do this in this population surveys. So you get a telephone call by a dietitian, and you have to tell her what you had yesterday. That's the past 24 hours. Not easy, if I can ask you, what did you have yesterday evening? It may not be easy, but this is how we ask this from the people. The results. You see here the beer preference people, the wine preference people, the spirits, and the non-consumers. That is what we compared. And you see here on the first row the numbers of the men, and we see here the percentages in brackets. So you can see here also in the Netherlands, the beer preference people are more male than female. While in wine, it was very few males, so it was more female, for example. The age, you see quite age, the beer drinkers were on average were 9 years younger. They drank a little bit more alcohol, as you can see here, ethanol. They were more often smokers, but they were also more men, so that explains it. The university education was higher in the people with the wine preference, and the energy intake, as you may expect, because they were more men, was on average higher in the beer drinkers. So this confirms a little bit the observations we made in our systematic review. This is maybe a little bit complicated slide, but this is to show you we have developed in our department a score, the Healthy Diet Indicator, which indicates to what extent someone adheres to the guidelines for a healthy diet in the Netherlands. And actually, the first component is physical activity, which is not diet, but of course, for maintaining healthy body weight, physical activity is important, so we include physical activity. So we have the same columns, beer, wine, spirits, and non-consumers. And we just look first at the first one, which is crude. So this is the crude data, unadjusted. And the adjusted column, the second column, is the adjusted. And the adjustments were quite broad. So for age and sex, because we saw differences between wine and beer drinkers in age and sex, but also BMI, smoking, educational level, energy intake, and also total ethanol consumption, because the amount of ethanol also varied. We took the beer as some sort of reference population. So the overall score indicates the higher the better. So the maximum score is 100, the lowest score is 0. So the total score varies, it's 58.8 in the beer drinkers, 66, so significantly higher in the wine drinkers, and then lower again in spirits, and significantly higher in the non-consumers. But you see that after adjustment, the asterisks are gone, which means that after adjustment, all the differences disappeared and were not statistically significant. Yes, so this is how you have to read this this slide. So in the end, you see all the adjusted columns, there were very few asterisks. Only, I think, here in the non-consumers, they had scored higher on the alcohol component, which means that makes sense. They were more moderate in alcohol components than the other ones. So this makes sense. And the other ones are all disappeared. So, which means that there is a difference in dietary habits, for example, as shown here, between people who prefer beer or prefer wine or prefer spirits or prefer not to drink or drink minimally. But this can all be explained by age, sex, smoking, BMI, educational status. So I think this is a very important observation. So the biggest contrast was detected between the beer and wine consumers. Better stop talking. The beer consumers had a higher intake of energy and other nutrients. We also looked at food groups. They had, for example, higher intake of potatoes and milk and breads, also meat, maybe because they were more often men, and adhered least to the dietary guidelines, but all these differences disappeared after adjustment for age, sex, BMI, etc. So this means that the differences between beer and wine consumers can be explained by those confounding factors, which often, I have to add, are not taken into account in all these cohorts. Some cohorts do, by the way. I will not discredit all the cohorts on mortality on cardiovascular disease, but often they don't. And this is intriguing because you wonder if they had this information available, if this difference between wine and beer drinking and this stronger effect of wine, this healthier, supposed healthier effect of wine on mortality could be due to the fact that they are highly educated, more female or whatever. So we think it's more driven by these other factors than there is really a real difference between beer and wine drinkers. Okay, so we have to look at the study design. We did cross-sectional studies. Usually you measure both, so you're not sure what is cause and effect. So maybe we'd like to do more cohort studies, and maybe we can do even a trial. But if we do a trial and we start giving people beer, I'm not sure if they're going to change their dietary habits because when they drink beer. Well, I think it's just they are both the alcoholic beverages preference and the other dietary habits are just part of one common or separate dietary pattern. So I think in future, when looking at these studies, comparing beer and wine drinkers, we really should be aware that they have done that they have the right information, and that the studies were able to adjust for these potential differences in associated dietary factors in beer and wine drinkers, for example. And this is just a final note, and we're not going to discuss now, but it's interesting to see what happens with the Mendelian randomization. We look at cohorts and we ask about alcoholic intake, but with some genes you can perhaps even study this further, but I have some question marks on this as well, but that's maybe for later today. Thank you for your attention. But first, I'd like to thank the sponsors, the Kennis Institute Bier, and especially ERAP, and especially also postdoc Diewertje Sluik, who is in the audience and has done, as you can imagine, quite a lot of this work. Thank you.